Okay, guys, warm welcome for those that are just joining us, or good afternoon. It's a big pleasure to have you here today while we are waiting for others. So just please hold on for a couple of, it's just a moment from now. We are getting started any moment from now. We are admitting people in the waiting room and trying to get the message fully across.
Oh, you can see this, right?
Yes, we can.
All right. That's nice. So, we're going to be learning about blockchain development. What is it? What's so special about it? Why it is an in-demand skill, right? Because currently, when you first hear about blockchain, you first think about Bitcoin. Like, if you ever heard of blockchain before, either after hearing about blockchain, you heard about Bitcoin, or you heard about Bitcoin, then heard that it runs on one kind of thing called the blockchain. So I'm going to talk about blockchain development today. So I want to welcome you guys. Thank you for being here. I want to see something in the chat session. If you tell me why you are here, what do you want to learn today? Just tell me something, or you can just introduce yourself, anything. I'm checking this chat session for your feedback. Okay, Michael, can you see the chat session?
Yes, I can definitely see this chat section on it. Okay, guys, so go to the chat section, signify that you're here and you're concentrating. Maybe you can just do a little bit of introduction, your name, and what is the main thing that you're hoping to learn today? What is the main thing that you're looking for to learn here today? So just click on the chat section. You can make the chat to everyone. Cool. I can see from Adikola, Diwali, player to have you guys there. Favor, one more. Favor is looking to, he's currently learning about Python.
Yeah.
I've been confused about this blockchain of the thing. You know, we have Udoka. Udoka is a web and mobile developer. It's nice. Interesting blockchain development. So yeah, keep it coming, guys.
Yeah, keep it coming.
It's coming. Let's see that you're participating. So that you're active. Okay, guys, so keep it coming. Your name, a bit of introduction, probably a shout out for the host or something.
So I want you guys to know that as we are here, I'm going to go through a lot of things in a very short time. Right? I'm going to go through a lot of things in a very short time. So I want you guys to put down your questions. I'm ready to answer every single one of them. All right, so keep them by your side, and I'm going to answer every single one of them. So let's start. Let's get in. All right, so welcome to the Blockchain Development Masterclass. Yeah. All right. So blockchain OU, right? What are we? Obviously, OU is in the name. So obviously, we are from Obafemi University. Group of students that are interested in blockchain development and are interested in letting mostly young individuals know that there are legitimate ways of prospering in this society currently. And blockchain development has brought in global opportunities for us to take part of, right? So sitting from my home here now, I can be working for a multinational company, and I'll be doing blockchain development for them and earning in dollars and pounds, like for you. I can even work for someone locally and collect money from the person, like serious money from the individual, right? So blockchain OU community, we are here to tell you that blockchain is not something that it's very difficult to learn. You just have to put in your mind to it. You have to be hardworking and you have to be consistent, right? So I already asked you guys your expectations. I've asked you your expectations concerning this session, but rest assured you're going to know what a smart contract is. And I'm going to also tell you how a smart contract works. So yeah, I'm telling you what you should have learned. Then you can follow us on Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, and YouTube. And Michael, please, can you drop the links there? We have different social accounts. So in case-
Yeah, I'll get on it.
All right. So for our future events, in case you might want to have information of our future events or you want to join our community, yeah, we'll give you access to everything. Then let's go to the next slide. So what is blockchain development? Yeah, what is blockchain development? Let's go to the basics. So Bitcoin, everybody knows Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is this virtual currency, right? So before Bitcoin, we had other virtual currencies, but there's something special about Bitcoin, right? So the process by which Bitcoin was made, right? The process of building the blockchain that Bitcoin runs on, because Bitcoin runs on its own blockchain. So the process of building the blockchain that Bitcoin runs on and adding Bitcoin to that blockchain is what is called blockchain development, right? Like I'm saying it in terms of Bitcoin right now. So that particular one that just for Bitcoin, it's Bitcoin blockchain development. So currently, there are other blockchain platforms that get specifically towards building, allowing developers to build on top of them, right? So Bitcoin on its own is a peer-to-peer platform, right? So it is built specifically for people to send and receive digital currencies, right? But it's not a platform that is built for people. It's not a platform that is built for people to build on top, right? So it's just built to have a digital currency that people can send and receive. So there are other platforms that are coming up, and some of them are already very popular. Platforms like Ethereum, and platforms like Polkadot, Binance Smart Chain, and others. So all those platforms, they are built specifically to let developers build on top of them. Meaning you can build the normal web applications that you see, right? The normal web applications that you see, like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, including Zoom, like they are platforms that let developers build on top. So those are the type of blockchain that we'll be concentrating on. So for this particular session, we'll be talking of Ethereum, right? So Ethereum is a blockchain that is built specifically for other developers to build on top, right? So that's what blockchain development is. So blockchain development lets you build applications that run on the blockchain, just as simple as that. The process of building applications that run on the blockchain. So examples of applications that run on the blockchain. So that is DApp, examples of applications that run on the blockchain. We have Uniswap, Oneinch, and Aave, right? So a DApp is an application, but it is different from other applications. The full meaning of a DApp is decentralized application. What makes it a decentralized application? The difference between a decentralized application and a normal application is the platform that you run on, right? So for a normal blockchain now, for a normal application like Zoom, like Twitter, like Instagram, the social media application that we have, including Facebook, all those applications, if you notice them, they are run by a centralized authority, right? They are run by a centralized entity. They are hosted on dedicated servers that are run by a particular company. And that company has, it is only that company that has access to that particular information, right? That is why it is a, that's why we just call it a traditional application. But for a DApp now, which is a decentralized application, if you are familiar with blockchain, you know that the blockchain is decentralized. So I've already told you that blockchain development involves building applications that run on the blockchain, right? So applications that run on the blockchain now are now called DApps. They have, the full name is decentralized application and the short form is DApp. So those decentralized applications are built on the blockchain. They inherit the properties of the blockchain. Now the blockchain is decentralized, right? So it is not controlled by one particular entity and it is spread across different computers that are called nodes. So that particular application that runs on those different computers is called a DApp. So very, very popular examples are Uniswap. So Uniswap is very popular, at least you must have heard of it. It is very popular. Uniswap, Oneinch, Aave, these are popular.
Hello, Nancy, please, you're muted. Unmute yourself.
All right. So where did I stop? My painting, where I stop?
The apps, you're explaining okay. The apps.
All right. So dApps, right? DApps are applications that are built on the blockchain. They are different from normal applications because they are hosted on the blockchain. And the blockchain is decentralized, meaning that those dApps inherit the properties of those blocks of the blockchain. So mean if they are on the blockchain, blockchain is decentralized, it effectively means that those applications are decentralized. And a very popular example is Uniswap. Everyone, at least everyone knows Uniswap. Am I right? Is there anybody in this call that doesn't know what Uniswap is? Don't be shy. Just speak your mind. Do you know what Uniswap is? If you don't, I'll explain it for you. I'm looking at the chat. If anyone doesn't know what Uniswap is.
Okay. We are from Favo Oluwatobi. I think there are some chats that signifies that they might need to explain.
All right. So Uniswap, yeah, exactly, like PancakeSwap. They are copies, exactly. That's what I mean. So Uniswap is effectively a sorry, I touched the slide by all right. So Uniswap is a dApp, right? So what makes it different is that it is hosted on the blockchain. All right. So what Uniswap is an exchange, right? So but is everybody knows Binance. So Binance is another exchange and Uniswap is an exchange. All right. So what Binance, if you want to trade your assets or your crypto on Binance, you have to first deposit it on Binance, then trade it. All right. So that is what happens with Binance. But for Uniswap, you don't deposit. What you do is that you just take your tokens or your coins, go to Uniswap and just, you don't need to deposit before you can exchange. You just swap it immediately. Like you just exchange it immediately. Right. So that's one of the properties of blockchain technology. So that particular what because Uniswap is hosted on the blockchain technology, we're able to do that. We're able to go on blockchain or on Uniswap without signing up, without KYC, without anything, and just exchange our coins. So that's what Uniswap is. It's an exchange basically, but it's a different kind of exchange from the normal traditional exchanges that we know, including Oneinch. Oneinch is also, it's not so popular, but it's also like Uniswap. It's also an exchange. Yeah, it's also an exchange. And these exchanges that run on the blockchain, they are usually called DEXs, that is decentralized exchanges, right? They're usually called DEX, decentralized exchanges. So Oneinch is also a DEX, but it's a decentralized exchange, but it's different for Uniswap in the sense that it also makes use of Uniswap in the background. Then also have Aave. Aave is another decentralized application. Aave is a money market. When I say money market, it allows people to lend and borrow money. So that is what Aave is. So basically that's what Aave is another decentralized application. So these are popular decentralized applications. So blockchain development, how do you start? How do you start building the next Uniswap? How do you start building the next Aave? Right? How do you start? So it's easy. Okay, sorry. This is supposed to be the next one. So what do you do to start building decentralized applications? First of all, although this isn't necessary, but this is the normal route everybody takes. For a blockchain developer, they are divided into different sections, right? We have the pure, like we have people that build directly on the blockchain. So to do that, you have to be able to build smart, what they call smart contracts. That is, this is the smart contract development. You have to be versed in smart contract development. So a smart contract is basically a piece of code that exists on the blockchain. All right, so that's what a smart contract is, a piece of code that exists on the blockchain. I write my piece of code, right? A normal piece of code that you write it, maybe JavaScript, just think of this. A normal piece of code that you can write it, your JavaScript, your Python, your Golang, or Java, any programming language, just take that piece of code and put it on the blockchain. It becomes a smart contract. So that's what a smart contract is. Now, because that smart contract is hosted on the blockchain, because that piece of code, your program now is hosted on the blockchain, it also inherits the properties of the blockchain, which are decentralization, transparency, it is public, anybody can view it. All those properties, it inherits them. And it is now able to do things that normal traditional applications can't do. So for blockchain development, they have different sections. The normal route is that when you want to start blockchain development, you need to start from web development, right? That is web development. When I say web development, I mean your normal front-end development where you need to know HTML, CSS, JavaScript, all those kind of stuff. that's the normal route. You start from there. From that place now, you have to be building user interfaces, right? You have to build user interfaces for people. That is interface in the sense that, you know, your normal Twitter now, what you see on Twitter is an interface. So blockchain developers are the ones that build the interface. They build interfaces for Uniswap, right? They build interfaces for Uniswap, One Inch, and Aave. So that what you see, right? What you see when you go on the Uniswap website, what you see when you go on the Uniswap website, blockchain developers do it. So to do that, you need to have the normal web development skills, which are HTML, JavaScript, and React. Yeah, right. You need to have those web development skills. Those are the normal front-end web development skills. Therefore, that is what you see. Then also, we need the piece of code to be hosted on the blockchain, right? So that piece of code that needs to be hosted on the blockchain, I've already told you, the smart contract. We need blockchain developers to also build those smart contracts that are hosted on the blockchain. So for Ethereum, because Ethereum is very popular and it is, to be honest, it is the most in demand blockchain. It is the most in demand blockchain for guys. When if you hear that someone is looking for a blockchain developer, it is usually an Ethereum blockchain developer. Right? They usually look for Ethereum blockchain developers to execute, to build projects for them on the blockchain. So that's just it. To build on the blockchain now, to build a smart contract on the block, to build a smart contract specifically on the Ethereum blockchain, you need to know Solidity, right? You need to know Viper. No, it's not necessary for you to know Viper, but it is. People usually look for Solidity programmers. So Solidity now is like any other, it's like any other programming language. It's just like Python, it's just like Java, it's just like JavaScript. But specifically, Solidity is for building, so writing smart contracts, right? So we also have Viper. We have Viper. Viper is another language for building smart contracts on the Ethereum blockchain, but it's not so popular, right? It's not so popular. Then also for smart contracts need to have security, like they need to be secure. We have different frameworks, right? That is, this framework, they help you to be able to write your smart contract in a secure manner, in a secure form. So one example of such a framework is OpenZeppelin. It helps you to be able to write your smart contract so it can be secure. If you have been in the blockchain space for some time and you must have heard of smart contract hacks. Yeah, so those smart contract hacks usually happen because the code exists on the blockchain and the blockchain is public, right? So those smart contract hacks usually happen because people are able to see the code. I'm able to see your code and know that, okay, there's a vulnerability in your code. Because of that vulnerability, because I'm able to read your code, assess it, and see that you have a vulnerability, I will not hack it, right? I will just hack it. So OpenZeppelin is a tool that lets you write safe smart contracts, right? Let you write safe smart contracts, but it's not absolute, meaning that even if you use OpenZeppelin, it does not mean that your smart contract is not hackable. It doesn't mean. It just means that they are giving you they are just telling you that, okay, these are the best practices you have to follow. And you can use some already made smart contracts that OpenZeppelin has made, right? You can make use of them to be able to build write your own smart contract. So that's just it. If you can decide to learn web development and smart contract development and become something like a full stack where you write smart contract and you also build the front end, right? And you also build the UI or the front end. Or you can just decide to become a full, like a complete Solidity developer, meaning that all you do is write smart contracts, right? All you do is just write smart contracts. You don't write React, you don't write JavaScript, you don't write HTML. All you do is just write smart contracts so you can build smart contracts on the blockchain, right? So that's what a Solidity developer does. Then, all right, so these are the parts. But before that, let's come here. So reasons for learning blockchain development. If you were here at the beginning, you have heard me when I said blockchain, like you can work for global companies with blockchain development. So recently, I've been having like people reaching out. Like people just keep on reaching out and be like, okay, you say you're a smart contract developer. Can you do this for us? This. And to be honest, I have to be honest with you. Like someone will just meet you and say, can you do this for us? The amounts that you charge them are like, honestly, they are, for instance, now is for to do a simple token. To do a simple token, that is an ERC20 token, the normal token that we know. It's very easy. Like that is one of the easiest smart contracts you can write. And someone can charge, you can tell when someone comes to meet you that he wants to do a token, you can actually charge that person $1,000, right? You can charge him $1,000 and you will charge him if he does not want to take your, like if he does not want you to do it for him, he can go somewhere else, right? You will just assure him that, yes, I will make sure that your the ERC20 token is secure, this. But I'm assuring it is high paying, right? You can charge as much as you like, charge like crazy. So, and it is, you can get high paying jobs also. Then you also have access to global opportunities. As I was saying, now you can have access to multinational companies, right? I can be here right now and be working for Uniswap. In fact, there's even a guy, Timmy Dan. Yeah, he works with a blockchain company that teaches people how to code. So that blockchain, and Mike is a part of that blockchain of that company. It's called Web3 Bridge. The guy works for Avigochi, right? He works for Avigochi. And Avigochi is a blockchain company. It's not Nigerian, but obviously it's a blockchain company, meaning it is like it's a global company automatically, right? So he works for them right from Nigeria here, and he's earning his money. You get what I'm saying? So that's one thing. And also first mover advantage. I don't know. To be honest, I did not start out as a blockchain developer. Although I wanted to learn blockchain development from the beginning. But I started out as a front-end web developer, right? Currently, anywhere you turn, like I'm very sure that every one of us here knows a web developer. Like I'm talking about someone that knows HTML, CSS, and JavaScript now. Everyone here knows a web developer. Like there are very many now. Like it's very hard to see a front-end developer that is vast in front-end development, meaning he knows all the frameworks and he knows everything about front-end development. Before you can reach that kind of person, you would have seen people that have little knowledge of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Like they are so ubiquitous. There are very many now. So I want you to know something about blockchain development. Currently, we have very, very few people in this space, meaning that is why you are able to charge much, because there are few people, meaning if you charge them and they say no, they will have to go and find someone else. And before you find that person, it will take a lot of time, right? And that person, if you find someone else, person might even charge higher. Meaning that before this place gets saturated, you have to take the opportunity now. So that is the first mover advantage. Come in now so that before we have an influx of other developers coming in, you would have been well-grounded and you would have secured your own location and your own spot, right? So we're expecting that in the next 10 years or next 10 to 20 years, we'll be seeing the same amount of people that do web development. It will just be the same as people that know blockchain development, meaning there will be very many, right? So before that happens, just pick your spot and be well-grounded. And so those are some of the reasons for learning blockchain development. There are many, but time is not by our side. So a smart contract. So for a smart contract, I don't know. So these are the parts of a smart contract, but I don't know if going through this now will be helpful. So I don't know. Let me get feedback. Do you want me to go through these parts of a smart contract, or you want me to write a full smart contract for you, or you want to see how it works?
Please, guys, drop your opinion.
How it works.
Drop in the chat so that we.
All right. Nice. Okay. Let's write a smart contract now. Okay, let's write a smart contract right now. So for smart contract, for this particular smart contract, I'm going to use Solidity to write it. I'm coming, this stop is blocking me. I'm going to be using Solidity to write it, all right? Yeah, I'm going to use Solidity. I'm going to use a tool called Remix. So Remix is an online editor. It's an online editor that lets you write smart contracts on the web. Right? I can write the Solidity code, which is effectively a smart contract on the web. So that is what Remix is. Even up till now, I have other IDs, that is integrated development environments. I have other programs that let me write smart contracts, but Solidity has proven so efficient that up till now, I leave all those IDs and still make use of Solidity to write like other smart contracts. So this is Solidity. I'm very sorry. This is Remix, right? This is Remix. So on Remix now, I'm going to write this particular smart contract. All right, let's get rid of everything here. So I'm going to write a very simple smart contract and I'm going to see how it works. So this smart contract I'm about to write, I have to tell you, it's not secure. It's not secure because I'm not following the security best practices. It's just something that I want to show you that, okay, this is how it works. And this. So just have a look at, you can code along. Just go to remix.ethereum.org, right? Go to remix.ethereum.org and just follow me as I'm writing out the smart contract. So the first thing for a smart contract, right? So basically, for traditional applications, they have what they call, like, for normal traditional applications, you can't see them, right? You can't see normal traditional applications. You can't see the code that they use in writing Instagram. You can't see the code they use in writing Twitter. You can't see any of those. But for smart contracts, I can actually see the code they use in writing Uniswap. I can see the code they use in writing Aave, right? But there need to be limitations on how that particular code is used. So for every smart contract, because the code is usually public and because a lot of people are going to see that code, we need what we call a license, right? So there's supposed to be something like a copyright kind of stuff. So there's supposed to be a license. So this is how I add my license to the smart contract. All right, I think this is it. Yeah. So this is a license, right? So this license, right? This license, it's licensed under this GPL 3.0, right? Sorry, the smart contract I'm about to write is licensed under GPL 3.0, right? So GPL 3.0 tells, like, anybody that comes to mine that checks out my smart contract sees that, okay, this license allows me to make use of this particular smart contract code to do this. So it tells you the do's and don'ts for that particular smart contract code, right? So that's what the license does. So this is the license that I'm using for this smart contract. So this is how you write the license that the smart contract uses. So it needs a license because it is public, it is open source. Then to go on now, I need to add the version that my smart contract is using, right? I need to add the version my smart contract is using. So to add the version, I'm going to use version 0.8.0, right? So that is Pragma Solidity 0.8.0. That is the version I'm using. I'm making use of this version of, it's not version of Solidity 90, but the version of the Solidity compiler. So Solidity on its own is a high-level programming language. If you have a familiar with computer, you also have heard of high-level programming languages, right? So Solidity is a high-level programming language. It's a high-level programming language. But for that part, for Solidity, the computer does not understand Solidity. What it understands is machine code. So we need a compiler to be able to convert that Solidity code to machine code, right? So to do that, I need to specify the particular compiler I want to use, right? So that is what I'm doing here. I'm specifying that I want to use the compiler version 0.8.0. If you come here, you're able to see, so this is it. You're able to see this compiler, you're able to see a list of compilers here. So these are the list of compilers that are available. So me now, I'm selecting 0.8.0 because that is what I'm using here. Get me, that's what I'm using here. So that's it. So back down to the token that we'll be doing, right? Down to the token we'll be doing. Down to the smart contract we'll be doing. So our smart contract is going to be a very simple token. So it very, very simple token, a token that, you know, a token now, you can send and receive a token. It's just like any other cryptocurrency, only that it is built, it is handled by smart contracts. So the difference between a token and a coin now is that Bitcoin, obviously, forget about the coin in the name, but Bitcoin is a coin because it has its own blockchain. So other blockchains that have their native currencies are called coins. So Ethereum has Ether, right? So that is its native currency. But for this smart contract now, I'm going to use this smart contract to create another currency. So because this currency is not native to the blockchain that I'm going to be deploying this smart contract, that is why it's called a token, right? So a token is a cryptocurrency that does not have its own blockchain. So that's what I'm going to be doing here. A very, very simple form of a token is what I'm going to be doing. And you're going to see it practically here. So I'm going to start it by writing contract. So I need to start by writing contract. Let's just call it coin. So that is my contract. So this is how I started. I have to start it with the contract keyword and the name of the contract coin, right? So that's how I started. Then from here, obviously, I need to also add. So for this particular simple smart contract, it's a token that people can send and receive, right? It's a token that people can send and receive. So I'm going to add that particular function that would allow people to be able to send and receive it, right? But before that, obviously, a token is, for a fed of Bitcoin, they have total supply and all that. So this particular coin, I want to give it a total supply. I'll have to give it a total supply. So I'll give it 256. Sorry. 256 per week. So I'm going to give it a total supply. I'm going to assign a value to the total supply later. Right. So if you look at this says the type. So for Solidity, like other programming language will have types like number, we have number, we can have boolean, we can have strings, we can have other types like muint, int. Each programming language has its types. So for Solidity now, you will find types that you have not heard of before. There are different types in Solidity. So for this particular contract, for this particular line, this line says I'm making use of 256. So this total supply is a variable and it's making use of type units 256 and it's public, right? So it's public, meaning anybody can view it, right? It's public, meaning anybody can view this total supply. So after the total supply, I want to also add decimals, right? I want to add decimals. What decimals do is that they let me specify the number of decimals that my smart contract is going to have. Whether it's going to have 2 decimal places, 3 decimal places, 4 decimal places. So the decimals allow a single, like, it's going to allow my token, right? Even if I have 1 token, it's going to allow that 1 token to be divisible into those number of decimal places, right? So if I have 1, it can divide it to 0.000, this 0.000, like that, right? So that's what the decimals, that's why I need the decimals variable there. Then after that, I'm going to have to put something there that will allow people to be able to check their balance, right? So people will be able to check their balance of the particular token I'm going to write now. So to check their balances, I can write balances. So it will be address map to mint 256. So I need to also make it public, right? So I'm coming to check for error. Oh, sorry. Sorry, I'm sorry. Stick there. Yeah, so that's it. So this is balances, right? So it's a data structure called a mapping, right? It's something like I give it the address. If I want to check my balance, I have to give the smart contract my address, then it gives me my balance, right? So you give the smart contract your address type. So when you give the smart contract your address, which is defined by an address type. And it gives you a unit 256. A unit 256 is like your normal integers, right? It's an integer. You know your normal integers now: -1, -2, -3, -4, -5. Your normal integers: -1, -2, -3, -5. That is both positive and negative whole numbers. Those are integers, right? So I'm making use of unit 256. So for solidity now, unit is an unsigned integer. Meaning it is not going to have a positive or a negative sign. It's not going to be, it's not going to have plus, it's not going to have minus, right? It's just going to be straight. It's just going to be a normal whole number without a positive or a negative sign. But if it was an int, right? If it was an int 256, if I were to remove this and put int 256, right? It's going to be either positive or negative. But since it is unit, which means unsigned integer, it's going to be only a whole number, no positive sign, no negative sign. So after that, I think I need to add comments. Let me add comments to this. Let me add comments. In decimals. Right, so that's this month. Then balance is returns. Okay, I need to add. So this the double forward slash is I'm adding. Tell the compiler that there is a tell you mix that the net that this particular line is a comment line, right? A comment is like it just tells anybody that is looking at the source code additional information about the source code. That is what the comment does. So I'm commenting on what I'm writing. So when you look at this particular smart contract code, you know that okay, this is what this line does. So this is what this line does. It returns the balance of an address, right? That is what it does. So your normal Ethereum address, if you were to give it to this smart contract code, it will give you your balance. That is what this does. Then the most bad, I'm going to tell you, okay, this was open as a constructor, right? So this is a constructor. Yeah, so this is a constructor. So a constructor, what a constructor does is that when you are done writing your smart contract, you need to put it on the blockchain, right? So before you can put it on the blockchain, you might want to initialize some things. When I mean initialize, you might want to set some things in place when you are putting it on the blockchain. The process of putting your smart contract on the blockchain is what is called deployment. So that means you are deploying it on the blockchain. So when I'm deploying it on the blockchain, I want to initialize some values, right? I might want to give the smart contract its name, and I might want to give it its symbol when I'm deploying it. So that's what I'm going to add now. So this constructor is a type of function that is run when I'm deploying my smart contract on the blockchain so that I can give the smart contract its initial values, meaning I want to initialize the smart contract. So to give the smart contract its initial values, the blockchain itself is going to run this constructor. Then after running this constructor, it puts the smart contract on the blockchain. So for this constructor, I'm going to give it some things they call parameters, right? So those initial values I'm going to give it are what are called parameters. So those parameters are going to be, I'm going to give it its name and its symbol, right? This, I've told you, this is a simple token. It's not an ERC20 token, but it's a very simple token. So I'm So I'm going to give this token a name, and I'm going to give it a symbol, right? So for the name now, it's going to be a string, right? String name. Okay, I'll add the underscore later. All right, string name and symbol. So this is going to be a string and symbol. So those are types, right? So I also need to specify. So these are the constructor takes in two parameters. Takes in two arguments, right? So these arguments, the arguments and parameters are the same thing. Just depends on the context you are using it. So it takes in two arguments, which are name and symbol, right? So it takes in name and symbol. Now the token I'm going to build is supposed to have a name, something like Bitcoin. The name is going to be Bitcoin. Now, this is an example. The name is not going to be Bitcoin, but this is an example. The name can be Bitcoin, but it's supposed to have a symbol, which everybody knows, which is going to be something like BTC. Bitcoin, BTC. So that is the name. The name is Bitcoin, and the symbol is BTC. That is, I'm talking about Bitcoin now. But for our own particular token, we're going to give it a name, we're going to give it its own symbol. Then, after that, I need to assign this name. This name and symbol are things that are going to be, public. They need to be public. Meaning that people that are outside, that is like entities that are outside the blockchain, need to be able to read this name and symbol from the smart contract, right? So I need to come back here and add it. Like as you build the smart contract, like you will have a skeleton definition of the smart contract in your mind. But as you keep on building it, you will notice that, okay, this is missing, and this is missing. That is why I'm going back now to fill in what I've noticed that is missing, which are the name and the symbol of this particular simple token. So I'm going to fill in the name here. So the name is going to be a string, obviously. So it's going to be string name, right? Then you will notice something now, then string symbol, right? Yeah, sorry. So string public symbol and string public name. The string is the type. Public means that it is going to be accessible by anybody that is outside the blockchain. And this is the name, this is the symbol. Then coming down here, I added memory here because Solidity, Solidity requires that for their particular data types, that their particular types like maybe string units. When I say types, I mean string units, string integers, that is units. So then it's on send integers, so there's unit and strings and bool, when I mean bool, true, false, that's boolean, and some other types. Those are the types that Solidity has. But for Solidity, there are some types like string. You have to specify the memory location that this string is going to be. So for this, that is why I added memory here, right? That is why I added memory here. So this memory here, I can also write it as storage. I can write it as storage. All right, so I can't put storage here, but for some particular locations, like if I'm adding, well, there are some particular locations that I can specify that the smart contract should store this particular variable in storage, right? So, but for here, it's going to be memory and memory, right? So the smart contract is going to put this variable in memory, and it's going to put this one in memory. So the memory will be, the memory will just hold the particular variables temporarily, right? While storage, we hold it permanently. So you have to take note of that difference, right? Memory holds the variable temporarily, while storage, we hold that variable permanently, right? So take note of that. That simple thing I'm just telling you now has led to people losing millions of dollars, right? It has led to a particular smart contract hack that has led to people losing millions of dollars. So any simple mistake you make while you're writing your smart contract can be very catastrophic. So for that, I'm giving it the name and symbol, right? Now I'm going to assign everything here, right? I'm going to give them values, right? I'm going to initialize everything here. So I'm going to give the smart contract this name here. I'm going to give it the name now, right? I'll say name equals name, right? So there is giving, obviously there's something wrong here. So it's giving me a warning here. So this yellow stuff is a warning. It's telling me that if you look at this place now, I'm saying name equals name. It doesn't make sense, right? So it's telling me that I'm overshadowing, like the compiler does not understand which is which. There's a name here and there's a name here, right? The compiler does not understand which is which. So to make it easy, I can just add an underscore here, right? Then add under underscore here. So the warning is supposed to disappear. I'm coming. Yes. Then so the warning is going to disappear when I make use of symbol. Right. It will disappear when I make use of symbol. And so I'm going to say symbol equals underscore symbol. Right. So that's it. That's it. Symbol equals underscore symbol. Then for the next one, I'm also going to initialize. I'm going to give total supply value. Right, we need total supply a value. For total supply, I want the total supply of my simple token to be 1,000. 1,000 is what should exist, just like Bitcoin, 21 million. So I'm saying mine should be 1,000. Then I'm also going to give decimals a value. Notice something here, there's something I'm going to do. So decimals, I'll say that the total number of decimals I want for my simple token is going to be 18. I want my simple token to have 18 decimal places. So that's what this simple token is going to have, 18 decimal places. Then if it's going to have 18 decimal places, the smart contract, I don't know, but the main thing is that I'm going to have total supply is going to be 1,000. The smart contract does not understand, like Solidity does not have inbuilt, does not understand decimals, right? It does not understand decimals. So I will have to add times 10 raised to power 18 here, right? So this means 10 raised to power 18. Actually, what I'm actually doing is that I'm going to have 1,000 tokens, but I'm going to have 1,000 times 10 raised to power 18 tokens. The 10 raised to power 18 part is going to handle the decimal part of my token. So the smart contract will think that I have 1,000 times 10 raised to power 18 tokens, but anybody that is reading the smart contract now is going to check the total supply. After checking the total supply, he now has to check how many decimals, right? How many decimals are specified for this simple token. So you will check decimals, then apply those decimals to the total supply. Meaning, if he sees that the total supply is 20 million, he will now have to apply, okay, if it's 20 million, it's going to have 18 decimal places. I will divide it by 10 raised to power. That number of decimal places, then that is my total supply. So that is why this is here, right? To make it easier, because when you write a smart contract, you have to take in, you have to think about gas, right? You have to think of, gas is, it's like, you have to think about gas. So gas, let's just say you have to think about the transaction fee that your smart contract is going to use, right? So to make it easier, I can do it like this. Right, do it like this. Yeah, so that's my total supply. Those are my decimals. Then for balances, I have to give someone a balance. So balances, so that's it. So the balances of This is a mapping. I'm going to give this mapping msg.sender. msg.sender just means the particular person that is calling that particular smart contract, right? So the person that is calling that smart contract is msg.sender. That person is going to be, when you check the value of msg.sender, is an address, right? So if I were to call this constructor, right? If I were to call this constructor, it is msg.sender is going to be my address. Because I will need an address before I can call this particular constructor. So it's going to assign to this address that msg.sender is going to return. It's going to assign to this address the total supply, meaning that when this contract is deployed, only that person will have all the tokens, right? So only that person is going to have all the tokens. Then down to, so for a simple token, the most basic of all is that we need to be able to send and receive a token. To send and receive a token, we need to add a transfer function, right? We need to add a transfer function. So that transfer function now it's going to allow people to be able to send and receive. But before that, let me add a comment here. So then we're going to add the smart contract, we're going to add a function now. Now this function will allow people to send and receive the simple token. Oh, that goes to send. Send and receive. Yeah, the same thing, send and receive. So this is the function. So to start a function, a constructor is also a function, but it's a special type of function. But this is the syntax for, this is the way a simple function is written. So for a function, I'll say function transfer, right? Function transfer. Then I have to also specify, if the function is going to be public or private. Now, public means that people will be able to access it. And what it means is that it's something that they call a modifier, right? So it's a modifier. So this modifier now, which is public, right? This modifier is public, meaning anybody will be able to call it. If it's private, meaning that nobody will be able to call it. Only the smart contract will be able to access it. We'll have other modifiers, and as you go along, you'll be able to see that those modifiers are really, really helpful. So to transfer, I need to tell the contract how much I want to transfer. I need to also tell the contract the person I want to send it, the token to. So I can say address receiver and event 256 amount. So it takes into arguments the receiver and the amount, right? So for the receiver part, are we all here? Are you following?
Yes, right.
So just keep your quest. Very sorry if this session is going to take more than an hour. I'm very sorry, but just I think to be honest, if you are really interested in this thing, you have to know that you have to sacrifice your time. It's the truth. If you want to do it, you have to sacrifice your time. So I'm very sorry if I'll be taking your time. So I hope I'm cool with that. But keep your questions. I'll be ready to answer every single one of them about blockchain development. So transfer. We need the address of the person. If you have used Trust Wallet before. Right, or in token or any one of those wallets, you notice that if you want to transfer, you have to tell the wallet the address you are transferring to, and you also have to tell the wallet the amount of the token that you want to transfer, right? So that is what is happening here now. I have to tell this smart contract the address I'm transferring to, and also have to tell it the amount of the tokens I want to transfer to. So to transfer, before you even transfer, the smart contract has to know that it has to check that okay, this person that wants to transfer has this particular balance. Right, so to get the person that I want to transfer, Solidity has given me a variable that will be able to tell me the address of the person that I want to transfer. So I'll have to check that the person has enough balance before it can transfer. So I'll require that the balances of msg.sender greater than or equals to amount. So greater than or equals to amount. So that's what this required does here. It checks that before you are able to send, you must have that money that you want to send. If you don't have it, you are not sending it. So that is what happens there. Then I have to now update the balances of the receiver and msg.sender. msg.sender is the person that is calling this code. msg.sender returns the address of the person calling this particular function, which is this transfer function. So I'll just update the balances, right? So just say balances of msg.sender minus equals. Okay, no, let's not go that way. So balances of msg.sender is equals to balances of msg.sender minus amount, right? Then it's simple math. I have to subtract from here and add here. So then I'll add So did the receiver or add to right? So I'm going to collect from this. I'm going to collect from this sender and give to the receiver. Whatever I'm collecting from the sender is what I'm giving to the receiver. So just as simple as that. That is what happens with the smart contract. Then, to make it, all right. I don't think we need the other parts. I don't think we need that for now. But yeah, what for the front end from the UI I was telling you about. Which, for example, if you were here from the beginning, Uniswap, you know, Uniswap has a UI. For the UI to be able to know what happens at the smart contract level, they are what we call events. So the smart contract emits events, right? It emits events that tell the front end that, okay, this has occurred, this has not occurred, so you get. And the front end is able to listen, the front end is able to listen to those events. So you can, but just know that that is what the front end uses. So for this now, let's deploy this particular smart contract. So the name. So for the name, I'll just give it a simple name. Let's say Funky Devs. Funky Devs. Funky Devs is the name. For and symbol, I'll just say FKD. Funky Devs. I want to deploy it to my MetaMask. You want to know MetaMask wallet now. My MetaMask wallet is connected to this one. So I want to deploy it with MetaMask. Right, MetaMask is taking time to load, but I'll use MetaMask to deploy this particular smart contract. So this is it. Yeah. So my for blockchain development, we have the main blockchains, right? We have Bitcoin blockchain, we have Ethereum blockchain. Those are called mainnets. They are called mainnets. They are where value goes through. But for tech, we have other blockchains that are called testnets. Those are like playground, sandbox for people to develop on and test their smart contracts on before they move to main blockchain. So for this particular smart contract, I'm going to deploy it on WinKeby testnet, the WinKeby test network. That is where I'm going to deploy it, and you're going to see it right here. So before I can deploy, this is fake Ethereum. This is fake. It's 0.992 Ethereum, which is a lot in like if it's real Ethereum, it's going to be a lot, but it's fake actually. So to deploy this smart contract, I need to have fake Ethereum in my balance. So to deploy it, I just come here, I've entered the name. To deploy it, I've entered the symbol and just click on transact. Right. So I just wait. I'll have to confirm the transaction here. Right. Confirm it here. And just wait. You see the smart contract to come up here. Yeah, it's taking time to load. So blockchain is the transaction is taking time to confirm. All right, it has been confirmed. And okay, you can see my can you guys see my MetaMask wallet? Hello.
Yeah.
All right.
I can't see it though.
You can't see it.
Yes.
Wow. Yeah, I thought you guys you can see it. Can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it.
Right, yes, right. Yes.
All right. I'll just confirm if you saw it before. So this is the purpose for a smart contract wallet. So this is my smart contract now. I can play with it here. I already deployed it before. So I can check total supply. I told you, if you notice, the name is public. I can check the name. Funky Devs, that's the name. Then symbol FKD, because symbol is public. That is why these are here. Then I can check total supply, which is also public. Total supply. This is my total supply, which was 1,000 times 10 raised to the power the number of decimals, right? This is the total supply. And I can check the decimals, 18. Then I can check the balance of my address, right? So this, my address is on my MetaMask wallet. I can check the balance of my address on MetaMask wallet. Then So this is the balance of my address. I call it. So I because I'm the one that deployed it, I deployed it here and I said I'm going to collect all the tokens, which is right here. So I'm going to escalate the tokens. I'm collecting the total supply balances of message.sender, which I was the message.sender because I deployed the smart contract. The constructor was called when I was deploying it on the message.sender. So I collected the total supply. Then to transfer now, I can transfer the tokens. But I want to show you the magic of this stuff. So since I've deployed a simple smart contract, I will be able to make simple transfers, right? I'll be able to make simple transfers using my wallet, right? So the tokens that you see that you have on your trust wallet, this is how they were written. Not exactly like this, but this is the kind of logic they were written. This smart contract is not safe, right? It's not safe. I'm just showing you something very simple. So I need to add it. This is the address of the smart contract. I'll copy the address and add it to my MetaMask wallet. Right, I'll copy the ID to my MetaMask wallet. So you can see my MetaMask wallet, right?
Yeah.
All right. So this is my asset, Ethereum. So I can add on that token, which I'm going to add now. Do you see that?
Okay, yes.
Yeah, so that's the token symbol. So that's what we just wrote everything, token symbol and decimal. So I'll add it next. It's going to tell me my balance. Sorry. There was a function I was supposed to add that I didn't add. So I'm coming. Let me add. I'll be quick. I want to add that function. So this function is supposed to be able to return the balance of anybody, right? So what is going to return something going to return event 256. So yeah, so it's going to be balances of address. So what it's going to do here is that it's going to return the balance of a particular address. Oh, sorry, I didn't have it wasn't address I used. So it's going to return the balances of a particular address, right? It's going to return the balances of a particular address. So all you need to do is that it's going to check for this address that I'm going to give it. It's going to check for the balance and then return it. So I need this particular function so that MetaMask, that's my wallet, will be able to tell me, okay, this is my balance, because the wallet itself checked that function. So to deploy it as we deployed it before, funky clips, FKD, transact. So just put down. Yes, confirm. So when it's deployed now, it has been deployed. So I just come to MetaMask and add the token. So I come to MetaMask and add it. So these are my assets. I can add token, add this one, FKD 18. Then yeah, you see my balance. This is my balance, 1,000.
Yes.
Yeah, so that is my balance. So MetaMask, what MetaMask did now, it called balance off, right? Collected my balance, then checked the number of decimals. Right, it checked the number of decimals of my contract so that I had 18 decimals, then applied those decimals to my total balance. Right, so it applied those decimals to my total balance. After applying it, it then found out that I had 1000 FKD. So I add my token and I have 1000. If I come to my assets, you will see FKD here, 1000. Now I can send this FKD. I can actually send it. So to send it, I'll just come to my second account, copy my address, right? Copy my address, come here, click on send, enter the address I want to send. I can send 100, let's send 100, 100, next, confirm, just hold on. It's sending. So I think I also need to add this token to the other address too. So as it will be able to see it, select it, send, then we'll see. is taking. Yeah, so it has sent, right? It has sent. So then we'll come to the second contract. I just sent it to this contract, right? I sent it here just now. So I have to add that contract address here. Add it. Oh, sorry, this is a personal. I have to look for the, yeah, this is the contract address here. Then I initially inputted my own address. That is why it behaved like that. So I have to add a token, enter the contract address, this FKD, token decimal 18, click on next. And now I have my balance is 100 because I sent 100 here, right? So that's just how it works. So the balance of this address is 100 now, 100 FKD. Then if I come here, we notice that this balance reduced by 100. So it's initially 1,000, it's now 900. That's a very simple smart contract. And this smart contract is just for example. It's to show example. It's not safe. This is not how smart contracts are written in the real world. So that's just how a smart contract works, a simple smart contract. So this almost copies the ERC20 tokens that we know, the normal BNB, the normal Uni, USDT, all those kind of tokens. That is what happens, right? So what I just did is what they do to launch their token. So anybody can launch his own token, right? So that's it all. And let's go back to our slide. I'm sorry. This has taken a lot of time. Very sorry. So let's go back to our slide.
It's worth it.
Yeah, it's worth it, right? So let me see. I think I can respond it from here.
You don't have to be sorry, sir. It was totally worth the time.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm looking for how to expand this. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, guys. So while our Nancy is attending to that, if you have questions, please ensure to type it now. So we'll start picking the questions from the chat.
No question is stupid. If you have any question at all, just drop it. I'm here to answer every single thing. I'm sorry, our other colleague was not able to make it. She had some issues. Sorry, she had some issues. I'm very sorry about that. But just drop your question. I'm here to answer them.
Please, if your mic is on, can you mute yourself? Please. Okay, thank you. Okay, so you can proceed with your question, your feedbacks, you know, to the chat button. Then if you feel you probably like to ask your question using our the microphone, you can just wait her and when we be asking for people to turn on their microphone to ask their question directly. Okay, so I can see some questions. We'll follow it thoroughly. So we'll start from the first question to the last. So if you have any now, please start dropping your questions so that we can quickly go through the questions. Nancy, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm listening. Let's just answer the questions. I'll drop all the links for resources and the different communities you can join. I'll drop everything in the chat. Right. So, what was the first question,
Michael? All right. So the first question is, why did it decide to go for compiler 0.8?
Okay. For why did I decide to go for 0.8? Actually, there was no reason. But you can decide to use any compiler you want. Only that for some compilers, right? There are set rules you have to follow. Like some compilers allow some kind of things, some compilers don't allow some kind of things, right? So, but you can decide to use anyone you want. There's no particular rule that when you are doing this particular smart contract, you have to use this particular one. In fact, people still use smart contract and they still use compiler 0.5. People still use 0.5 people just love 0.5. I think 0.5 stayed for a long time. So that's why people love using it. So what's the next question? I think, did that answer your question? So I think Yetunde, did that answer your question?
Yeah, please turn on your microphone and let's know if you're satisfied. All right. Okay, so moving on to the next question here, I'll try to be quick. What factor determines the amount of token you created? Yeah, I think that's
So the number of tokens I created, if you check my smart contract, you will see a place I wrote to tau supply. I'm coming. Let me see if I can reshare this. Let me see. I'm coming. I think I should be able to reshare. All right. Yeah, let's go and reshare it. Let's share this. Can you see this?
Yeah, we can.
So total supply. This is the total supply of the token.
Yes.
So this is what determines it. Total supply. So when I defined total supply, then I gave it a value in the constructor, which was 1,037 decimals. So that's it. Did that answer your question?
Please turn on your mic. Let's know if you're satisfied with the response.
No. Hello, sir.
Does that mean the decimal can be of any number?
Yes, it's you. You can decide to do anything you want. Nobody's stopping you. You can put one as decimal, you can put 10, you can put 2, you can put anything you want. It's your smart contract.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move to the next question. Let's move to real quick. Okay, so I have the next question here from Okunwala Timilayin. Sir, are there offline IDEs we can use for the development, or there are only online IDEs for now?
Yeah, so for IDs, you can use VS Code. VS Code is very popular. You can use VS Code. Yes, you can use VS Code. You can use Vimix also has an offline version that you can use. You can check that out. So yes, there are offline IDs.
All right, thank you. So next is from Kausi. Thank you very much for this. Can a complete newbie with no knowledge about programming start his or her joining as a blockchain developer?
Yeah, you can start in Solidity actually. I'm going to drop a link for you guys. So that you can start learning Solidity, right? So I can see the chat now actually. Where you stop, Mike? So I'll just answer it.
Next is Olani, your cousin. Do you think Solidity is still worth learning?
Where is the question? Okay, do you think Solidity is still worth learning with the minus of new blockchain supporting smart contracts? Thanks in advance for clarification. Okay, so to be honest, if you ask me, I will say I'm someone that is part of the Ethereum community, right? So I might not be the right person you want to ask that question, but to be honest, Solidity is worth learning. You can't tell me Solidity is not worth learning. Like, it is worth learning actually. Based on the fact that every day, even as we are speaking, new smart contracts come out that are powering billions of dollars, right? They are powering billions of dollars that are written in Solidity. Other blockchains are coming out that let you write smart contracts in other languages. Examples are Solana. Solana requires that you write your smart contract using Rust. Rust is on that programming language. Yeah. Then there's Polkadot. Polkadot, I think you need to write it using sub. I think there's one you call the write it using sub. Is it sub? Is it substrate? I think it's substrate. Yeah. Polkadot is substrate. And there are others, but those other blockchains do not have the community, right? They do not have the community. They do not have the following. They do not have the support. They do not have the tools for you to be able to write it the way you can write smart contracts on Ethereum using Solidity. So that's just it. So the support, the community, those are also factors that determine the path you want to take, right? So for instance, now for all those other smart contracts, it might not have been easy for me to just show you the code online, right? It might not have been easy for me to do that using a mix, right? So that's just it. Then I have noticed most smart contract use the 18 decimals. Why that particular value and what's its purpose? All right. So I don't know why most contracts use 18 decimal pieces. Well, I can tell you this. You know, Bitcoin decimal pieces is how many now? I think it's 3, 9, 11. Yeah, Bitcoin has 13 decimal pieces. Right. So those are sats. The lowest is one sat. So Bitcoin has 13 decimal places, but Ethereum has 18 decimal places. The reasons why they use this, the reason why they use decimal places, right, is to allow the value of that token to be divisible. Now, one property of money, right? One property of money is that it should be divisible. If I give you 100 naira, you should be able to divide that 100 naira from me to 20 naira, 5 naira, 10 naira, right? So for a token, the reason why they use 18 decimal places is that it should be divisible into smaller places. But for why they particularly use 18 decimal places, I can't tell you why they do that. But for Bitcoin, I can give you why Bitcoin has 13 decimal places. You know, there are some people in the Bitcoin world that still feel that Bitcoin is going to be used for peer-to-peer coins. Like, it's still going to be used not only for store of value, using on that property of money, not only for store of value, but also for people to be able to buy things in the grocery store, to be able to buy things in the local kiosk. So for you to be able to purchase all those little things that are worth 5 naira, 10 naira, you can't use one Bitcoin. So it should be divisible into smaller pieces of 0.00000, blah, 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 sats, right? So that you're able to make use of it. So that is one reason they use decimal, but I can't tell you why they use specific number of decimal places. Even for tokens that represent layer, right? So I don't know if you know NGNT. NGNT uses two decimal places because it is representing Naira as a token, right? So a Naira only makes of 0.00. So there's no reason why you want to use 18 decimal places for Naira. Like, there's no reason why you want to use 18 decimal places for a token that wants to support Naira, right? Just use the two decimal places that Naira originally has. So that's it. Then, does that answer your question? You can, what are you doing? Is he on the call?
Yes. Right. You answered my question. Thank you very much.
All right. So another
is... Aliu Ajimo is raising hands. Aliu Ajimo, can you please?
All right. Talk. Anything you have to say, boss?
Aliu
Ajimo.
Okay, please, let's move to the next question.
Okay. Another is, how is created token monetized? I can't tell you this is how the token is monetized, but this is it. Anybody can create a token. You just have to give that token value, right? So the way people usually monetize their token is that... Hello? Can you guys hear me?
Hello, we are with you.
All right. So the way people usually monetize their token is that they assign their token to be used in... They can provide a particular utility. A very simple definition that people do is that they can give a particular utility and say that, okay, in order for you to access this utility, you have to get that token, right? So that is one basic thing Ethereum does, and including Bitcoin. In order for you to make use of Bitcoin, right, you have to have Bitcoin. So in order for you to pay a fee, for you to pay the transaction fee on Bitcoin, you have to have Bitcoin. In order for you to pay the transaction fee on Ethereum, you have to have Ethereum. So that is one monetary strategy people using monetizing their stuff. In order for you to use their products, they can say, okay, you need to have this particular token. Sure, you get. So that is one method, but there are numerous. I'm not versed in that aspect. I just write the code. So the next question is, Ali, you are now.
Ali, you jump. I'm not sure. Please, let's proceed.
All right. So, however, I am new to the tech space. What other skills do I need in order to arrive at being a blockchain developer? All right. So, the skills you need to be able to code, you need to be able to write programs, you need to understand blockchain, you need to understand what blockchain is, right? You need to be able to read. You need to be able to read like crazy. Like, you should be able to wake up and just read non-stop, because innovations in the blockchain space don't stop. They keep on happening every day. Even as we're speaking here now, if I go and check Twitter now, I will see that they have brought out a new protocol, a new DApp, a new smart contract has been released that allows people to do this, to do that. So you need to be able to read, and you need to be able to keep abreast with what is happening in the blockchain space. One, reading, you need to be able to read, you need to understand normal, simple economic terms. You need to understand simple economic terms. You need to be able to code, right? Then that's just, and maths. I don't want to say you need to know maths, but currently that is where the blockchain space is tending towards. there are some people that there are some positions that you need to know a little bit of maths. I didn't say you need to know maths, a little bit of maths, right? But me, I can't tell you I know maths, right? But that doesn't stop you from becoming a blockchain developer. There is nothing you can learn if you put your mind to it. Just sit down and learn. It was very simple. Sit down and learn. Be ready to keep late nights, right? Be ready to keep late nights and ready to start your coding journey. Then, okay, please, what exactly is mapping as a data type? Like, what is mapping keyword for? Okay, mapping is something that I used it in the code, right? I used it in the code. So mapping is a type of data structure that assigns, like, which term will I use for it now? It's not, I don't know if you are, who is asking this question? Let me see. Okay, Yetunde, is she here? Hello,
Yetunde. Hello, Yetunde. Yes, she's here. Please unmute yourself.
Can you unmute yourself?
Yes, I'm here.
All right. Are you familiar with Avis?
Yes.
Avis, kind of. Okay, which language have you encountered Avis?
JavaScript.
Okay. So you know that for arrays now, what you usually need to do is that to get a value, an array like structures, it arranges values. It arranges values based on their index, right? So the value at index zero, if I tell the array that I want the value at index zero, it will return that value to me. So I can get values using their indexes in the 0, 1, 2, 3. I just tell the array that I want this index, it returns it to me. So for a mapping now, what it does is that it not only allows you to access those values using index, right? It can map an address, right, to 0. Like what you can do is like it can map Yetunde to, based on what I did in that contract, you can map Yetunde to the school she has, to the school that she is in. Can be Yetunde to OAU, me now to UI, then on that person to Kuta. So that's what the mapping does. It allows you not only to use in numbers, which are indexes, which is 0, 1, 2, 3, which an array does. It allows you not only to use what an array has, like those numbers, but allows you to use other bigger data structures like string. So I can map, I can say that a string, if I give this mapping, this string is going to give me another value that pertains to that string. So something like that. So it links two values together. So what I did for mapping now in the token was that I linked an address to its balance. If I were to give the mapping this address, it gives me its balance. Right. So what it does is it maps two values together. I map the address to its balance. Does that answer your question? I know it's somehow. Is it okay? Hello?
Yeah.
No, you were about to say something.
Yes, I was, from what you said,
okay,
it sounds to me like an assignment operator kind of data structure. But I'm not, I might be wrong. Maybe that's not what it
is. Yeah, it seems like. Yeah, almost like that. You can check the Solidity docs for more information though. Just check it out, right? Yeah. So this, I didn't get the transfer part where MetaMask was introduced. You'll be watching the recording. All right, no problem. Just watch the recording. So, okay. If I want to use Solidity for VS Code, do I just install the program and combine it? Okay. Yeah, you can just install the plugins. The plugins give you the compile. So this question is, if I want to use the Solidity for VS Code, do I just install the plugins and I'll be able to compile it, or the other necessary things to do? So you can just install the plugins for VS Code. It gives you the option to compile, but usually people make use of what they call Truffle. So Truffle allows you to be able to compile your smart contract Solidity code. So that's what people usually make use of. I have VS Code and I have those plugins. I don't make use of the compile command in those plugins. So, okay, please. Oh, Michael, hello. forgot to do this. I'm coming. I'll be going to do something.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you're telling me to do something. All right. I'm just saying. Oh, it's Favor Day, me. Favor Day, me.
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, you're asking about Shatu first, she said. All right, so SHA-256, so what SHA-256 does is that it's a hashing, what you call a hashing algorithm, right? So it's something like, I can take your name, Favor DME. So what's, all right, let me start from here. What SHA-256 does is that it takes a string of any length, something like the total number of schools in Nigeria. If you take that total number of schools, take it in and produce a string of a fixed length. That is what hashing algorithm to like that's what hashing algorithm is. So for SHA-256 now, it is employed in ultra blockchain. Like one thing that blockchain is known for is cryptography. So it employs SHA-256 and other hashing algorithms to be able to can be to store data, to encrypt data and other things. That is what they use SHA-256 to do. So for smart contracts now, you can decide to use SHA-256 in your code, right? You can decide to use it to represent. Okay, let's go higher level. A simple thing like mining. SHA-256 is used there, right? So what it does is that to mine a particular block, it's something like Bitcoin mining now. To mine a particular block, transactions are in that block. So for me to represent that block, I have to hash all the properties of that block and produce a presentation of that block, which is a block header, right? So that is one place that SHA-256 is used. Another place that SHA-256 is used, right, is for addresses. It's used to map a private key to a public key, not only SHA-256. It's not only SHA-256 that are using that stuff, but other hashing algorithms and encryption techniques are used in mapping private keys to public keys, right? So that's one way SHA-256 is used. You can check Google for more explanations, but as you learn Solidity, you understand it better. So I don't have a deep knowledge in cryptocurrencies and I'm an aspiring blockchain developer. What advice can you give me to someone? Can you give to someone like me to enhance my knowledge and understanding the concepts that I've been using this space? Okay, I would advise you to start now. That is as simple as that. Start now. There's no time to waste. Time is going, we're getting old. Everybody's doing like, are getting old. What will I tell my children that I was wasting my time? She said, the main thing is that you should start now. Time waits for nobody. Start now. So for you to start now, I'm going to drop a link in the chat that talks about that you can use for starting now. This link explains, like it's a video. It's a YouTube video. There are different YouTube videos actually. So that link will tell you how to start Solidity and to explain everything about Solidity for you. So you can start there. So that's the YouTube link. Okay, please start. The token you just created, on which blockchain did you build it? Oh, I built it on Winkeby. So Winkeby is a testnet. Is a copy of the Ethereum blockchain, right? I built it on Winkeby. So Winkeby is a testnet where no view value exists today. You can get fake Ethereum, fake whatever, and make use of it on Winkeby, right? So that's one thing. Then I think that's all. Okay. I think all questions have been answered. All questions have been answered. So to start your blockchain development journey, make use of, I shared the link before, but let me just paste it again. Make use of this. You can make use of this. Yeah, you can make use of that YouTube link. Okay, let me share. Please note the slide, but I have something for you guys. Okay, yeah, let me share this. I'm very sadistic in time. So let me share this. Let me share this.
Please ensure you're sending to everyone. We have not been seeing a couple of the links you've been pasting.
Oh, I just sent two and they are the same thing. Oh, I think okay, it was a direct message. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm very sorry. I'll be sending it to one particular person. Oh, yeah, that's the link. That is a link to a YouTube or a series of YouTube videos that will teach you about solidity development. So I'm very sorry about that. So let me share this Google Doc. I'll share this Google Doc with you guys. So this Google Doc, can you see this Google Doc? Hello?
I can, okay. The can one you see? Display or the link you sent?
No.
Okay, I can see the one on your screen.
This Google Doc that my mouse is on, can you see?
Yeah.
All right. So learning resources. You can join some, I will share the link of this Google Doc on the Zoom. So okay, it's public already, so I'll just copy it or copy link and I'll share it in the Zoom meeting. Oh, I can't access that part now. Okay, chat, I'll share it right here. Then I'll share the link here. I'll access the Google Doc here. So this is where I started, Consensus Academy. So Consensus is they teach you how to become a blockchain developer. It's a global company. So for you to get started, you need to join some communities and Consensus Academy will teach you. So Consensus Academy, to join them, you have to pay a fee of $1,000. Right, that is the last time. Oh, cool down. Just hold on. You have to pay $1,000, but just follow their Twitter, follow them on Twitter, follow their check out their website. So, but the $1,000 that you pay can be covered for you by African Blockchain Alliance at Afri Blockchain on Twitter. This is how I got started, right? I think that was last year. Yes, that was last year. Afri Blockchain, that is African Blockchain Alliance, put out a tweet that, although I knew Consensus Academy before, I knew that the price was $1,000, but it was too much for me. So I was just hanging around. And I saw when African Blockchain Alliance put out a tweet that they are looking for applicants that want to learn about blockchain development. They are looking for them to apply to Consensus Academy. They are going to cover the fees. It's completely free for you. They're going to cover everything, the full $1,000 will cover it for you, but you have to put in the work to be able to learn how to build decentralized applications and smart contracts, right? So that's about it. So follow at Twitter is very important. Follow at Afri Blockchain on Twitter, right? At Afri Blockchain, follow them on Twitter. Follow them on Twitter because currently, Afri Blockchain. Okay, no. Currently, Consensus Academy will soon start their next cohort. That is the cohort after mine. Now they are going to start it very soon. They are looking for applications. Obviously, you have to pay. So be on the lookout at Afri Blockchain. I'm suspecting that they are going to put out a tweet very soon that will require people to apply for the scholarship to join the Consensus Academy. So be on the lookout for that, and key in when the opportunity arises. Then. Okay, I'm coming. I need to delete some things. All right. So then there's Web3 Bridge. Michael Jerry is a part of Web3 Bridge, and I can show you. If you don't know anything about web development, if you don't know anything about blockchain, come to Web3 Bridge. They'll teach you HTML, CSS, JavaScript, OpTube, Solidity, every single thing. At Web3 Bridge on Twitter, the website is web3bridge.com. Follow the document link. And ABC developers, I don't know much about them. I don't know much about them, but I heard that they also teach people, right? And I think they also offer scholarships too. So you can check them out. This is their website, that's their Twitter link. Then Blockchain OU Devs. We have a community of blockchain developers, right? We have a community of blockchain developers. You can just, if you are not in the community, you can reach out to us. Right, as you are wanting about the in a community, that as you are writing your code, you will come across different errors and you will need help at one point or the other. So we're always there for you. You can, if you are not part of our community, you can join us by sending a mail to blockchain.ou@gmail.com. Mike, please can you drop that in the chat? mail to our, send a mail to blockchain club where you are gmail.com saying that you want to join our club and you want to join the blockchain EU devs community, and tell you how to go about it. Then for YouTube videos, Eat the Blocks and DApp University, right? So Eat the Blocks teaches you how to become a blockchain developer, like deep, it goes deep. So these are free channels on YouTube where you can learn from. Then for newsletter, to know what goes on in the blockchain space daily, you have to join, you have to follow a newsletter. You can follow this newsletter, this is optional, it's not necessary. You can check out this newsletter to know what goes on in the blockchain space weekly. Week in Ethereum news, they tell you what goes on in the blockchain space, because the blockchain space is like, people keep on coming in daily. It's at the peak of innovation, it's at the edge of innovation. New things keep on popping up daily, right? So you have to join, you can decide to follow the newsletter. Then Twitter, follow these accounts on Twitter. They are very important. So these accounts, like, your Twitter should not be meant for just socializing alone, right? You have to put yourself out there that, okay, I'm a blockchain developer. Update your LinkedIn profile. Update everything about you that says that you're a blockchain developer, right? Update everything about you to say that you're a blockchain developer, so that people will know that, okay, this guy is a blockchain developer. If I have a blockchain job, I can reach out to him. So you can follow these accounts. My account is there too, but I don't tweet much. But just follow them and start your blockchain journey. Check out your tweets, right? So at your timeline, we tell you, your Twitter timeline, like, so by the time you follow this account, your Twitter timeline will always be copying out, bringing out blockchain stuff for you to always get involved with or get interested in. So some of these accounts are Nigerian and the likes, right? So then GitHub, right? So this is, you should have a GitHub link by now. You should have a GitHub link by now. A GitHub link is very important for you to start building yourself up, right? So currently, people usually check your GitHub links so that they're able to know, okay, how your GitHub is a place for you to store code, and it also have something that can be able to measure how active you are with GitHub. So people usually check. So currently, people check GitHub accounts to know how good people are before they can employ them. So joining GitHub and having a good GitHub account is very necessary. So I already posted, so this is the DeFi. If you know DeFi, is decentralized finance. It's something that is making waves right now. You can start your DeFi journey by following by checking out this GitHub link. Check out our GitHub link. Yeah, you can check it out. It'll tell you about everything about how to get started, being not only a blockchain developer, but tell you about how DeFi works, like decentralized finance works. I already sent this to the chat, right? I already sent it to the chat. But let me just send it again. I think that's all. We're done for today. Thank you very much for staying today, and I'm very sorry for taking your time. All right, thank you. So, Michael.
Thank you so much. Thank you, guys.
Feel free to say thank you.
Thank you so much.
That's fine. And nobody is saying thank you. I'm not a developer. I'm just a moderating event. that's awesome. Thanks so much, Nancy. Thanks so much to everyone that waited, you know, till this is done. I'm sure this is worth your time. And in the future, we are looking to having you around. You can see a link to join our community. It's important that you belong to a local club. There are opportunities, discussions that you might want to partake in. You see opportunities you want to share with others. A local community, a local club is very important. Please do also follow us on Twitter, follow us on subscribe to our YouTube. We'll be posting this video on YouTube, so you probably don't have to stress yourself. Those ensure you're subscribed so that if you post the video, you get to see the video. For people that missed some of the sessions, we'll write to you, sending the link to the YouTube in a couple of days or a couple of hours as well. Then if you have anything you might want to say to us, you can reach out to Nancy, you can reach out to us on Twitter, or you can reach out to us. We want to say a very big thank you. And let me use this opportunity to tell you that something big is coming. If you're a new student, something big is really, really coming. this semester, there will be a very, very big physical meet. I mean, a very, very big physical meetup to be hosted by us and other stakeholders. You're definitely going to see more announcements about this later. Nancy, let me say this again. Thank you so much. In absentia, blessing. Emma, thank you. She had assignments to sort out, and that's why she cannot be here this evening. When you join our community, you get to meet with her. You can follow her on Twitter at the blessing. Emma, follow Nancy at Nancy Odian. Or you can follow our blockchain club too at blockchain club AU, and you can follow me at the Mike Ojeri. Thanks so much for joining this evening, guys. We would appreciate your feedback on Twitter. When you see a post about these events, please do drop your feedback on Twitter. We want to say thank you and have a wonderful evening.
All right. Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you.
Yeah, bye, guys.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Yeah.
Bye. Audio Jungle.